Please welcome to the stage, President and CEO of LGBTQ Victory Institute, Mayor Anise Parker.
Thank you. Actually, I'm happy to see so many folks here this morning. You know, we've done this conference for a long time. On the last morning, we start a little later. Probably should have thought of this a little more strategically. The fact that we had the big women's party last night, and then we have the women's discussion this morning. So I know a lot of folks it was hard for some of us to wake up this morning. But I'm glad to see so many folks here, and I know people are going to be coming in. This is just a quick side note. Often during this conference, because we have so many public officials in one place, there's a lot of conversations about how we can help in the broader context of politics. And often there are statements issued by the attendees at the conference. And John Heilman, who is one of our senior attendees at this event, has drafted on behalf of elected officials at the elected officials preliminary day and the meeting a statement that you may find at victoryinstitute.org/116. Reggie will send an email out to our elected officials who are here so that you can also get the link and see a copy of the draft statement, which is a statement of principles on behalf of our public officials here. But it calls on our president, members of Congress, for passage of the Equality Act. And we know with our new members of Congress that that's definitely going to be high on the list. And presumptive Speaker Pelosi has said that that's going to be one of the first things they do, but we want to show our support for that. But passage of the Equality Act, continued efforts to fight HIV and AIDS, and specific protections for trans people within the government and in all aspects of federal activity. And then fourthly, improving our commitment to LGBTQI rights globally. So you may see the full text of that again, victoryinstitute.org/116. Thank you.
Please welcome to the stage Colorado State Representative Leslie Harrod.
Well, good morning, everyone. How's it going? You are the few, the strong, the mighty, the maybe hungover, who are here this morning to share in this amazing panel. Are you ready? Well, I am State Representative Leslie Harrod. It's my honor to be here with you this morning. I am the first openly LGBT African American to hold elected office in Colorado. Very proud about. But I am no longer the last or the only, because we just elected another African-American LGBT person to hold a seat in Denver in the RTD, and we're very excited about her. She's not here with us today, but she will be here next year, and we're really excited to have her join the ranks of African-American LGBT people in Colorado, because guess what? There are LGBT people in Colorado, and there are Black people in Colorado, so most people are often shocked to hear that. And I'm also proud to be so involved in the Victory Fund and Institute. I am an alumni of the campaign board. Campaign board members here. I am a graduate of the Victory Institute, and I'm a Victory endorsed candidate and a Bennett Fellow. So I've got to say thank you to all of Victory for all you have done to help us out to make sure that we are strong elected officials and that we win our races to begin with. So thanks, Victory, for that. Well, so this panel is about the year of the woman, right? So women actually led the rainbow wave. Women have been rock stars this election cycle, but particularly LGBTQ women have really led the movement to ensure that we have diversity in office and that LGBTQ women run and win. And so this morning on this panel, we're going to be talking to a few elected officials to talk about what it's like to be an LGBT candidate and elected. And we're also going to be having some friends from HRC and Emily's List talk about how they got there and what we can do to make sure that all of our friends join us in the state houses and in local government and in Congress. So without further ado, let me welcome up my panel. Come on up, guys. Ladies. Hello. We didn't practice how these couches were going to feel before we came up. We should have done that, right? Little lesson for us. Well, I'm going to have everyone just introduce themselves for a second, and then we'll go into some questions. How's that? All right. Let's get started.
Good morning. My name's Nickie Antonio. And thank you. And thanks, Mom. And I am... I am currently a state representative, the first openly gay, lesbian, anybody from the LGBT community to be elected to the state house. I am also the senator-elect, also another first. And I'm the first woman that will hold that Senate seat in the history as well. So we broke a few glass ceilings, which is really exciting. My background is that I've been a teacher. My partner and I were lesbian super moms in our community. We were soccer moms long before I got involved in elected office. I was an activist and advocate working on women's health issues, HIV and AIDS, public policy and funding, and all of the things, even trying to make sure that our parks had a skate park for our children. All those things led to me being in elected office, and I have always worked on two axioms. One is guard the perimeter. For whatever reason, I'm always guarding the perimeter, paying attention to what's going on. And the second is my goal in life is to make the world a little bit better than when I found it. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brianna Titone, representative-elect from Colorado, House District 27. And as you probably know, I'm the fourth trans woman to be elected to state government in the history of the country. And I'm really proud to be here tonight. I'm a geologist and a software developer. I've been a volunteer in my community my whole entire life. Started out as a volunteer firefighter when I was 16 throughout high school and college. I'm the HOA president, which is I get probably more credit for than being an elected official now. I also volunteer for another group called NecroSearch International. We're a group of interdisciplinary scientists, and we help law enforcement locate clandestine graves and evidence. And, you know, I wanted to be an FBI special agent, and when that didn't end up working out for me, when I turned 37 and I got too old, I was kind of trying to figure out me, and that's when I came out as being trans after that. And soon after that, the president was elected, and I really started paying more attention to politics and making sure that I was going to be a strong activist for myself and others that were really marginalized. And that's how I ended up getting into office. I'm a first-time candidate. I worked in the mining industry before this and in software. And I just want to make the world a better place and make sure that the right kind of things are being done in my community. And we have a strong person who's going to listen and do the people's work. So thank you.
Hi, good morning. My name's Geri Prado. I'm the senior director for state and local campaigns at Emily's List. It's always Emily's List. It's always great to follow several amazing leaders at 9:30 in the morning after a great night of partying. So at least the couch is very comfortable. So for those of you who aren't familiar with Emily's List, we have been around for 35 years. Ellen Malcolm was our founder, and we are dedicated to electing pro-choice Democratic women. The amount of work I think that this entire group has done together, all of these fantastic wins, I think really come from the fact that no longer were women and LGBTQ candidates going to sit back and expect someone else to make sure to fight for their rights. And so this cycle was, I don't want to say the beginning, because I will say if it wasn't for women, the women to the right of me on this stage running before, we would not have had this cycle. And so that is an incredibly important thing when you look at Representative Leslie Herod and think she was one of the first to really bust through barriers and be a groundbreaker and really helped pave the way for this cycle. And of course, for us at Emily's List, it is about recruitment. We had over 40,000 women sign up. Just so you know, we usually have to, and JoDee, who knows this all too well, having been in Emily's List, we usually have to drag, we have to find women, really recruit, and we still had to do that, but usually it is a long process. This time, we had one of the best recruiters, unfortunately, take office in our as the President of the United States. And that is both a good thing and a bad thing it's many things. For us, in terms of recruitment, again, it really pushed women to come out and run for office. And not only run for office in wait in line, like we're usually told, LGBTQ candidates, I think women candidates are usually told there's somebody in line after that, maybe you consider running. It's usually also in typically Democratic seats. We saw so many LGBTQ candidates and women run in conservative districts where nobody thought that anyone except a straight, white, older male could run or should run. And so I think all of those things are just monumental to see. I'm really grateful and proud to have been a part of electing so many amazing women. But you know what? Just looking at them and listening to them, it is no wonder that people knew they would be the best fighters for their communities and for fighting for the rights for as long as they're going to be in office. And for us at Emily's List, it's not just about one cycle. We're with you for your entire career, for better or for worse. So whether you want to hear from us about fundraising for the rest of your life, but no, we love it. We're very proud of the work. And the last thing I'll say before I turn it over to JoDee is, this is not about one group. It's not about one group who's able to do all this. This is only happening because we're all doing this together as a movement and multiple movements coming together. And so I want to be clear that when we're talking about credit, it's credit for everyone because it's just not possible for one group to do this alone across this country. So thank you. Glad to be here.
Good morning. JoDee Winterhof, the Senior Vice President for Policy and Political Affairs at the Human Rights Campaign. Thank you. As Geri alluded, this is not my first rodeo. That's a gentle way of saying it. And I want to highlight just a couple of things and why I'm very grateful to be with this group this morning to have this conversation. Trying to elect more women and elect more women to higher office has been part of my life's work. And so as I think about this conversation, I think this is the continuation of a long conversation about seeing women's leadership to the highest levels in this country. And part of what, as I look back on my career, and I've done four presidential campaigns, multiple Senate campaigns, the first congressional campaign I ran 25 years ago was for a woman in Iowa. Had she won, the Northwest Iowa district that Steve King currently holds probably would have looked a lot different. And I wish history would have been a little different, but I probably wouldn't be here with you today talking about this. And so as I look at what we all have brought to this, and I think Geri's made a couple of important points. I've been at HRC around 4 years now, and I in part came here because I wanted us to try to figure out what was next after we had won marriage equality. And I felt there was still so much to do, but I felt like people were going to kind of take a pause, and I wanted to be a part of that next chapter. And so as we think about some of these folks and these important elections and what we're up to, I've had the good fortune to work on Capitol Hill. I served as Kyrsten Sinema's chief of staff in her first term. And was able to work with her and see what an amazing leader she was, and many of you already knew that. HRC also already knew that. She'd been a local leader for us for a long time. And it was on the tails of having spent time in the United States Senate for a number of years with Tom Harkin, and I served as his chief of staff as well. And so those perspectives were interesting to me, but they also are good reminders. When I was a Senate Chief of Staff, I was the only openly LGBTQ Chief of Staff in the United States Senate. And so as we think about these victories, as folks are coming forward from these elections, we have made great ground. So the idea that Tammy Baldwin was reelected and Kyrsten Sinema was elected, we've doubled the number of openly LGBTQ folks, and we kind of chuckle when we say it, but it's important for us to note, it's important for us to count. And I think as we think about the successes up and down the ticket that we have seen, it's important for us to learn these lessons. So I'm grateful to be here this morning. I look forward to learning and hearing from all of you. I'll turn it back over to you. Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Well, as you can tell, we have a pretty phenomenal panel this morning. For those of you who are watching from your beds, we are live streaming this panel as well. And please be sure to make sure if you hear anything that you want people to remember or know who are not here this morning, that you do use the hashtag for the conference today and that you post on the conference app as well to encourage folks to get down here, but also to get some of these pearls that they're going to share with us today. So we're going to start with Senator-elect. You are the first openly gay representative to serve in both the Ohio House and the Ohio Senate, the first woman to occupy the state Senate seat for District 23, and earlier this year, you were named the most influential LGBTQ activist in the state of Ohio. Right? Wow. How does breaking those barriers affect your life as an elected official, and what additional pressures or responsibilities do you feel?
Well, to begin with, I think it's interesting. I was having this conversation with Barney Frank yesterday, and I said, I really feel a responsibility to, you know, if we're leading the path and we're forging a path forward, the idea is that people will follow on that path, right? And so I feel some responsibility for that. And as has already been said, 2 years ago, I was trying to get women to run for office in Ohio in our caucus because I was in leadership in the caucus. And it was very difficult. It's even more difficult to encourage folks who are from the LGBTQ community to run. And so I feel a lot of responsibility on setting an example of how to serve openly, authentically, without apology. And I think that without apology and without any sense of shame about who I am, who my family is, has been sort of the biggest light bulb, I think, for my colleagues. I had an elevator conversation when I first came to the legislature. A gentleman said, oh, you're Nickie Antonio. You have a partner? And I said, yes, that's good language to use. Good for you. This was 8 years ago. And he said, oh, tell me about that. And so I talked about my family, my partner, our daughters, and then I asked him about his family. A couple hours later, we'll call the first guy Legislator A. Legislator B came up to me and said, I hear you had a conversation with Legislator A. You know, that guy's a knucklehead. He said to me, you know, I had a conversation with Nickie Antonio, the new legislator. She's so normal. Legislator B said, and I said to him, well, of course, you knucklehead, what'd you expect? What I learned from that conversation, from both those conversations, was Legislator A had never met someone from the LGBTQ community who had absolutely no embarrassment, shame. I was normal in talking about my family just like he was. Legislator B wanted to make sure I knew that he was the more enlightened of the two. And it turns out even later that I found out that Legislator A had a twin brother who died of AIDS. He had never told anyone. His family was appalled at the time. He has carried around some guilt and shame himself. And so we had a wonderful conversation about that when he talked to me about it. I say this story, I tell you the story, because I think the pressure on us sometimes is very public, very under the lights of how will we perform, how will we be. And at the end of the day, we will perform and be the same as the rest of the legislators. I represent 120,000 people just like the person next to me and the legislator next to them. And I think I do feel a responsibility to reach back and pull my sisters, brothers, and trans folks with me up into those offices. But I also know that I have to represent all of the people, and I want all of the people I represent to understand being from the LGBTQ community is a part of who I am. It's not all of who I am. However, I will never back down and never be ashamed. I will always be proud of who I am and who my family is.
Awesome. Thank you. All right, Representative-elect from Colorado. Yes, we are crushing it in Colorado. Brianna Titone. In 2012 and 2014 and 2016, Republicans won your district, House District 27, by 10 to 15 to 13% respectively. Those are big margins in a very conservative district. But you, a transgender woman and a Democrat, flipped this red district by less than 500 votes. You are not supposed to win. And now you will be actually physically occupying my office and one of the only freshmen to office in the Capitol. So I want to know, and look, I mean, I've watched this race very closely. I want to know, what was that moment that you had when you realized that everyone else was wrong and that you were going to win that seat?
Yeah, and during the counting of the votes, everyone was saying how nervous they were, and that was a nail biter, and they kept refreshing the feed from the Secretary of State. It wasn't changing. When are the votes coming in? I'm like, I don't know. Our clerk and recorder in Jefferson County was up for re-election too, and she wasn't doing very well in the polls, so they were a little bit lax on getting the votes counted. You know, I looked at the numbers when I filed for running for this office, and I saw that Hillary Clinton won the district. And it was probably by a similar margin that I won. And I was like, well, that's enough. And since 2016, we've had a lot of new Democrats and unaffiliateds coming in the district. So that was very promising. And it's like, well, I just need a little bit more votes than the other person, and I'm going to win. I was running against the incumbent in the beginning, and everyone really thought that was, you know, well, forget it. You're running against the incumbent in this tough district. There's no way you're going to win. And I said, well, you know what? Hillary won the district. I can win this district too. And we pushed on, and we came up with a plan, and we got a great team of people to work for me. And we went out to the doors, and we had a lot of conversations. We knocked on about 48,000 doors, and I was still working, and I was going to school at the same time as I was campaigning up until August. So my team did most of the door knocking, but I did several thousand doors myself. And there was a conversation that I had with a few different people, and this one particular guy, he was probably in his 60s, and he was outside doing yard work, and I said, hey, are you so-and-so? And he's like, yeah, who are you? And I told him, you know, I'm running for House District 27, and I wanted to tell you about myself, and are you a Democrat or Republican? Well, I'm a Democrat. Oh, well, I don't like the Democrats. I voted for Republicans down the ticket. And he went on and on and on about every negative thing about Democrats you could possibly think of. And I was like, oh, I got to get out of this conversation. I'm wasting my time here. I got to move on to someone who's going to vote for me. And, you know, I just stuck with it. I let him vent, and then finally, you know, he asked me about myself, and I told him, and I said, well, you know, I'm the HOA president, and I was a former volunteer firefighter, and I was giving him all my credentials and all my degrees and stuff like that, and he's like, well, I'm the HOA president where I live here too. And we started a bond over that HOA connection that we had and all of the dumb stuff that we have to deal with on a regular basis. And that was enough to really, you know, get that conversation moving in a positive direction. And at the end of the conversation, after he told me that he voted for every single Republican, he goes, you know, I'll probably vote for you. And that was a really big turning point for me, because I was like, wow, you know, I can actually flip some people's minds here, and I only have to do that with one or two people over my opponent, and, you know, I can actually get enough votes to win. So, you know, we had several more conversations after that with similar people that were very disillusioned with the Democrats, and I said, forget about the federal stuff. It doesn't matter. It's the state stuff that really matters, and this is what I'm going to do for you. And that was really what, in my mind, I knew we had a chance to win, even though all the naysayers said we weren't able to win.
Yeah. Wow, thank you. I think that's pretty phenomenal. It really goes to show you how important it is to be on the doors if you're a candidate. You know, if you are a state or local candidate, you need to knock those doors, because it's those personal connections that really make a difference. And in your case, 500 of them is what made your difference.
439.
439. Who's counting? Thank you for that. Okay, JoDee. 2018 was a watershed year for LGBTQ candidates in Colorado alone. I don't know why these keep coming up. We elected the first openly gay governor, Jared Polis, and we elected Brianna, Colorado's first transgender state legislator. What is driving these gains? Are voters thinking differently about their elected officials' gender identity and sexual orientation?
I mean, you know, yes and no is the answer to that. What I'm seeing across the country is that folks are really wanting to know what you're going to do for them. And I heard those echoes in both of the legislators' comments, connecting to your constituents, et cetera. Most of them are not sitting around their kitchen table talking about your sexual orientation and gender identity. Some of them are. Some of the more conservative folks are. But not the bulk of the folks. And what we're seeing in research, just in terms of folks supporting equality, pivoting from what we've learned around marriage, where we're now up to 6 in 10 or so and beyond, Americans support marriage equality, and they support, as a community, our full legal equality. And so that, those gains and seeing those things come up as support as opposed to opposition, I believe, is one of the keys to understanding that folks aren't so worried anymore about somebody being LGBTQ. And I also think across this cycle, we do have some examples of folks trying to use the issue against our candidates, and our candidates being quite adept at basically saying, I'm running because this is what I'm trying to do for this district. It's what I've heard, and it's what I will go do. And to be honest, in many of these districts as well, there are some folks, and this is true, I know, of Nickie's opponent, that he actually worked against us a little bit in Cleveland. And our folks kind of like to know that. And so there is also power in pointing out, and I'm not saying the candidates as individuals have to be the ones to do this. That's where some of the groups come in to do this, is that folks also want to know who doesn't support equality, who doesn't support folks who are LGBTQ, and that is powerful as well. And so I've seen that combination work out well for many of our candidates across the country, and I think it's only going to grow. And if you have a chance to ask Kyrsten Sinema this question or Tammy Baldwin this question, how many folks brought up their sexual orientation in the campaign? I bet it less than a dozen people did across time in terms of individual conversations. And so I just think it's we're at a much better time than we were 5 even 10 or 10 even 5 years ago.
I think that's exactly right. One thing I found so interesting the day after we elected Jared Polis, I looked on my news feed and I thought it was going to be, yay, we got the first gay governor in, or, you know, he's gay, take him down, whatever, you know? Instead, it was, he's gay? What? No one knew. I mean, like, so many folks had no clue, but that was the headline the next morning was, you know, first gay governor. And you realize that he connected with people based on our Colorado values, based on what he was running on, not necessarily the historic nature of his race or the fact that he was gay. And so I thought that that was really interesting, and I think I was a little taken aback by how many folks, I mean, I've known Jared's been gay for a long time, right? How many folks had no idea, I just found that really fascinating. So Nickie, this was mentioned a bit earlier, but in your election, the primary was much closer than the general. The county party got involved and endorsed your opponent. How did you pull ahead as the LGBTQ candidate going up against your party in a primary?
Yeah, that was fun. You know, it's always nice to have an internal family fight and be the one on the outside. I remember about 3 weeks before the primary, I really didn't know how it was all going to go. So we did a small poll, and we found out that we actually had a chance to win. And we'd been doing all the things Brianna talked about. You know, we've been door knocking, phone calling. We're very folksy. We send out little handwritten postcards. Volunteers sit around a table and just write and write and write all day about why they're supporting me and why the voters should support me as well. I mean, we do everything. Lots of mail, whatever. So we had done all the things you're supposed to do. My opponent, endorsed by the party, had not really come out anyway negative. He was holding his breath because he had a Me Too issue in his past. And so there was an independent expenditure that reminded the voters about that. Thank you so much for that. Thank you, some of the people in this room who contributed to that. I still have friends that come up to me now and tell me they contributed to it, and they ask me if I'm allowed to know now, and now I am allowed to know. So that was part of it. We stayed on message. We stayed talking about the policy issues that were important to the district. I especially went into the district that was the most conservative part that did vote for Trump. I have a little bit of that in my Senate district. I showed up. I talked to people there. There were two conversations that told me I had a real chance of winning. One was with a firefighter who said, asked me about myself. We had a conversation at a public event, and he said, he took my card, he looked at it, he said, I'm going to tell all the guys at the fire station who live in this community to vote for you, because so far as I'm concerned, the men have screwed everything up, and I'm giving the women a chance, and you sound like you know what to do. And I thought that was awesome. The other conversation I had with somebody at a door, it's interesting. The guy was out raking leaves, cleaning up his yard, and I introduced myself. We started talking. He looked at it. He said, equality, what's that all about? He looks at it. He looks at me. He goes, oh, are you the gay one? And I said, as a matter of fact, I am. And I pulled out another piece of lit that had my family's picture on it. And I said, here's my family and blah, blah, blah. I've been a teacher. And he said, huh, you know what? If you're going to be honest about this, I can trust you about everything else. I'm going to vote for you. And that's how you win.
Authenticity is real, right? We have to be authentic. Voters like that the most, I believe. I think that's why a lot of us are sitting here. All right, Geri, I'm coming to you. Historically, state and local elections haven't gotten much love. Most Americans probably can't name their state representative or their state senator. What has that meant for women running in state and local elections? Was 2018 any different? And was this also the year of the down ballot woman?
so many things, yes, on all fronts. But I will say this about state and local. My background is largely federal, and at one point I realized that, you know, yes, there's gridlock in Congress and all of those things, but just working on specific issues, so many things happen at the state and local level. Workers' rights, pro-choice, Roe v. Wade, all of these things happen at the state and local level. So I think people really understand, and particularly the women who are running, really understand that you can make a huge impact at the state and local level. And it's not just about Congress. But you're right, most people know who their member of Congress is or who's running, but they don't know who's running for state house or state senate or their city council. But I think more and more people are understanding that these elected officials are the keys to making their communities better. So I think there's a brighter light on local and state and local, and I think that happened this last cycle, frankly, because you can't move anything in D.C., right? Yeah. So now I think that's going to change because there's so many amazing women who have been elected to Congress, but still, state and local is not just a pipeline for federal. It is in that you see amazing women, you know, moving up, but it is also where you need to control levels of government so that you can make sure that you have equality representation, that voting rights, all of these different issues are taken care of at the local and state level. So I think we saw a lot of that, and I think the women who ran were very authentic. They absolutely, I mean, this is true of women and, of course, other progressive candidates, but they were just very authentic about who they were and what they wanted to represent. So that was very helpful in terms of running campaigns and getting women in to say, yes, they're going to run, or many women came to us and said, I'm already running. So I think it was the year of the down ballot women and that there was more attention than there had been previously. Do I think that that's enough? Absolutely not. I think that we need far more women and far more LGBTQ candidates running. This is the beginning of, I think, a mass amount of women of color and other diverse candidates running, but it cannot be the end. It needs to be far more than this. I think you see a lot more candidates thinking, I can do this. I mean, look at the leaders you have here and the examples you have. Now you actually see women and LGBTQ candidates in office locally, and think of how many impressions that makes on the children in those communities and the families there saying, wow, now that could be me as well. Well, they've never seen a role model in these positions before. So I think that all of these things are, you know, a perfect confluence of a continued momentum around state and local. And I do believe it was the year of the down ballot because you saw so many women say, I want to be public service commissioner. That is the first time anybody has ever said those words, you know, and they meant it. And in Georgia, you know, you had somebody saying, I want to be the insurance commissioner. And the public service commissioner in Georgia, for example, is incredibly powerful. You have some of the highest energy rates in Georgia. Think of what you can affect, and it really affects the poorest communities in that state. So there's so many opportunities to make things better for communities. And therefore, I just think this is, you know, people really understand that this is where it's at. And the state and local women, the women who ran, I mean, these are leaders at all levels. You know, it doesn't matter where these women are, they're going to be leaders. And they're always going to be fighting for the right thing. So I think in terms of state and local, yes, it was the year, but it's just the beginning. And so I'm very excited to see that.
Can I add something too, is that what we saw in my campaign for sure, but I think we saw this across the country, was that, again, the great organizer that's up in that White House right now, what I saw was people that have always been nice to me but never got involved in my campaign were all in. They got involved, and we also had Emily's List, HRC, the Victory Fund, all kinds of organizations, and then boots on the ground for us as well. But there was this energy. Young people came out. I had volunteers working on my campaign. They couldn't vote yet, but they were involved in the campaign. They were door knocking. They were doing all this. It was amazing. And I think that energy and that excitement was that we could make change at a more local level, and they saw it and believed it. And I think that made a huge difference as well.
I agree.
And I think that's exactly right. And we saw that in so many women. The thing that I do want to also say, and I think everybody's alluded to this to some extent, but you all know this very well, That just does not mean that the democratic and progressive institutions are incredibly welcoming of all the women who want to run and all the LGBTQ candidates, right? We actually had to show. So I do want to say it is incumbent upon all of us to really push. And how many times, and I'm sure this happened with the women on this couch, were told, you know what, it's great that you want to run there, but you need to wait your turn. Or that there's somebody who's been waiting in line, or you know what, that district really is a more conservative district that looks whiter, straighter, more male, whatever it is. So at Emily's List, and I think this is very true of everyone here, we are sharp elbows. It is. We see it as part of our job to make sure that when we are told that, or when our women are told that, and they have been told that, I mean, it happens all the time, and they're by Democrats. They're not, this isn't just a Republican thing. This is our own party saying, you know, yes, she doesn't quite look like the district. For us, it is absolutely as a staff person's job to say, you know, we disagree, and she's going to run anyway. And you can have him run. We're not saying he shouldn't run, but we are saying that she should be given an opportunity, and she's going to, and chances are she's going to win. So I do think I want to make sure that while this was a great year, it doesn't mean that all the institutions have changed. And so, you know, always remember that. Think of the buzzwords. You know, it's almost like when you hear, well, they're not experienced enough. You know, there are different words. The same is true for women who want to run for these more conservative seats, and definitely true with LGBTQ candidates. So I just want to say that because I want, at Emily's List, we know that this isn't it's not all done. You know, we're not like, oh, this was a great year. The Democratic institutions are with us and behind us all the time. But, you know, we really have to do, we have a lot of work to do there.
I think that's right. So basically what you're saying is women are not going to wait in line for anyone anymore, and definitely not behind any man for any reason. I gotta agree, you know, in my race, I was not endorsed by my local Democratic Party either, nor the Democratic activist in the mix. And I think that is typical for primaries, and that's why I started the Haired Leadership Fund, where we actually endorsed in primaries diverse candidates to represent and to make it out of their primaries, so that now we have one of the most diverse caucuses in Colorado history. So, yeah. We got to get out there early and support candidates if we want to truly see diversity. So I'm going to ask one more quick question, and then we're going to open it up to the audience. So get ready for your audience questions. And it's going to go to Representative Titone. You have said that Virginia State Representative Danica Rome inspired you to run and was an advisor to your campaign. What would you like to say to transgender folks across the country who are now looking up to you in the same way, and considering running for office in 2019 and 2020?
Yeah, that's actually really correct. I was considering running for office, and I was like, well, I mean, is anybody going to elect a trans person to state office? I didn't think it was even possible. And the 2017 election, when Danica Rome actually won, I declared my candidacy not that long after that. I was just like, okay, somebody did it. It's possible, and I know that with some hard work, I can do it too. And I sent an email to her, and she reached out to me and said, you know, go to the Victory Institute training, and you know, take as much training as you can, and knock on as many doors as possible. That's really going to be how you're going to win this race. And we did, and I didn't get a lot of support from anybody, and it wasn't that anybody told me no, because in this district, you know, having a Democrat even run was like, you know, nobody was clamoring to run against the incumbent in this seat. They just weren't. So a Democrat was like saying, hey, I want to run, and they're like, sure, go ahead and knock yourself out, and I did. I knocked out the opponent. But along the way, when I was knocking on the doors, you know, and a lot of the reporters have been asking me about, you know, what have you been hearing at the doors? Has anybody been saying the hateful stuff? Because they really did. In Danica's race, they attacked her for her identity quite a bit. And I thought that maybe, you know, the Republicans really learned that's a bad tactic. I think they're still going to do it again to her next year. But in my race, they really didn't. It was just a few people on social media that said some bad things. But I heard a lot more positive things. And I heard so many people say, thank you for running. And, you know, my kid really looks up to you. And everywhere I went, it was inspirational things that people were waiting in line to tell me at events. And that was what really helped me work as hard as I could. Because I knew that winning this race was a lot more important than just me flipping a Republican seat and getting more Democrats in our caucus, but it was about getting the people that really needed someone to do something with everything that's been happening. And we will not be erased hashtag that's been going on. You know, I said, well, we will not be erased, we will be elected, hashtag, we will be elected. And that's what I want to promote in the next coming years is, you know, to have more people use those hashtags when they start to run. We will not be erased, we will be elected, and we will show them that we are people that belong in leadership and we are going to do the right things for people, and people don't care about this. They just want representation and people to listen to them, and we have to try so much harder. And I've always been the person in my life has always tried harder because I always felt like, you know, no one really likes me. I just want to blend in and disappear. And I always had to try to be more than I ever could. And that's how I got really qualified to run for this office. I always tried really, really hard. And I will always really try really, really hard. And I know that a lot of people like me are a lot like me in that respect. So anybody who does want to come to me for help running for office, you know, I'm paying it forward. Danica Rome helped me out so much, and I will do the same thing because it's necessary. We really need to get more people elected.
That's awesome. Thank you. So it sounds like if you're thinking about running, run, work your butt off, and then win, right? All right. So are there any questions from the audience? All right, Luana. Okay. Pat. The good students in the front, you are also here early. You were also here early. I saw you. Yeah, so yeah. Good job.
We're staking it out. So Tom Perez in 2018 gave congratulatory remarks to the African-American women in Alabama who kept a predator out of the Senate. Hold it. Y'all taking my time. Wait a minute. And then in this last election, there was, I can't remember which paper it was in, but there was a story about African-American women fueling the wave. My question is, so many times we run for office, I'm African-American, I'm a woman, I'm a veteran, I'm an ordained minister, I'm a lesbian, what else am I? Anyway, yeah, good person. So when people like me run, all the time we don't get the support from the outside communities, but there's also times when we don't get support from the organizations who are supposed to represent all of who we are. And I'm just speaking as an African-American woman because most of us don't get that kind of support. We work on the campaigns, we knock on the doors, we make the phone calls, we do all those things, but so many times when we get ready to run, you know, we're kind of told, well, there's a man, and you just wait a minute. And so the political class gets behind him, and once again, the African-American woman is on the sidelines. So how can we change that? Y'all can clap now.
Right. Thank you for that. All right, I'm going to let the two organizations take that question.
Well, I think one of the ways that we can change that is by looking for these opportunities in unexpected places. One of the things I'm hearing from Brianna is that she really took a look at a seat that others weren't. So I think there are opportunities there that we should take a look at. In terms of some of the other races, HRC has primarily over the years looked more at federal races and the top of the ticket statewide races. One of the things we started to do in this election cycle was to look more broadly in a number of states, and we endorsed 200 more candidates than we ever had before in the history of the organization. In doing that, in looking at new candidates, we also tried to look for opportunities to reach further into communities, not just like the level of the race, but also into different communities. And so of those folks who were not elected to office previous, over half of them were women, a third of them were people of color. And I think we will continue to see those opportunities rise. One of the ones I would point out is in Arizona, we started to work with the Latinx caucus in the legislature. Interestingly, the whole Latinx Congress, or caucus, pardon me, was made up of gay men. And so we're looking for candidates there who are lesbian or transgender or queer and seeing how we can expand our reach into other communities, but also supporting their efforts there. And I do think it takes that intention. You know, it's also in partnership. I think you pointed out Alabama and the Roy Moore election. We have staff on the ground in Alabama. We also knew that we were not the best messengers in that state, and we worked with a number of local organizations in the Alabama NAACP and gave them resources to message to their members and, frankly, also to equality voters. And so I think there are different ways to approach this question, but it takes a lot of rolling up the sleeves and honest dialogue around that and reaching to different conclusions than we have in the past.
So I appreciate your answer, but I think the question was specifically regarding black women. And I think oftentimes when questions are asked about black women, people start talking about people of color in general or about other types of work that they're doing, but unfortunately can't speak to specifically what they're doing to support black women or black LGBTQ candidates. And so feel free to jump in, but you know, I think the question that we're asking is, what is HRC doing to support, if you typically support at that congressional and the federal races, what black candidates are you training and getting gearing up for 2020, and how can we help support you in supporting them?
Well, we don't train candidates. The Victory Fund does that, as does Emily's List mm-hmm. and others. That's not a piece we currently do. It's part of the reason that we do financially support the Victory Fund and mm-hmm. support Emily's List. So we work with candidates when they come through those trainings a little more. You know, we have endorsed some of the African-American candidates, but what I'm hearing you say, Pat, is to reach further into those endorsements. And I know Luana's sitting away from, or a couple seats away from you, and we've worked with Luana locally. And I know Luana knows we've done good work, and we've done work that hasn't been as good as we want it to be. And so I think that we do have to reach further into communities to do that work and to find those candidates. But we really do rely in part on partnerships in terms of the trainings and other things.
Yeah. Yes, and I think this is it's a great question for so many reasons. And for us at Emily's List, and we partner with HRC and we try to partner a lot with local groups. For us, it is women take up to 8 times to ask to run for office. You have to ask over and over again. Why? Because, frankly, they're like, I never thought I could do that. I have kids. There are a million reasons that usually women, we say that we can't do it. That's changing, which I think is fantastic. What we have noticed when we're going into communities of color, and in particular with African-American communities, the thing that tends to be a little bit more intimidating is fundraising, building that support, because, frankly, there aren't a lot of programs dedicated to going into African-American communities, and I'd say other women, I'd say other communities of color as well, to say there is a nuanced difference in terms of having, I would say it is really hard to ask for help. There's a lot of, I think, pride and hardworking women who have tried to do everything themselves and not ask for help. So when it comes to fundraising, what we are seeing is that we do have to work more one-on-one with African-American women to say, don't worry about asking for help. Let us work with you to build your support system. And frankly, that takes a lot of one-on-one time, which we are dedicated to doing. We have increased our staff at the local level from 4 to 17. And a lot of that this year was just like drinking out of a fire hose, but we did try to get more into communities. And so for us, it is more being more intentional that there are nuanced differences, and we have to be more assertive to going in and saying, no, you're the one we want to run, and we want you, and we will work with you from the beginning, from the beginning of your career, we will help you in terms of raising money. The thing I think a lot of African-American women, and I would say this is probably true of men, but I'm here talking about the women, is that viability. You hear this word viability a lot. And to us, viability is, do you want to work hard? Are you committed to your community? I think it's also, though, a code red word for, can you raise a lot of money? What we have to go into communities and say with a lot of our African-American women candidates is, we know you can raise money. That to us, the viability is, are you willing to do the work? But we go in and say, we will teach you how to raise money if you're not comfortable with it. So for us, it's a lot more hand-to-hand work, but it's definitely something that we are trying to get better at. And it's a lot of important work, but I think everybody should be committed to do it. And so for us, yes, it's the big trainings, but it's gonna be our staff going in one-on-one and working with African-American women. And we saw far more, and we endorsed far more African-American women candidates run, because frankly, a lot more African women said, yes, I am going to run. So we are committed to that. I think we all have to be committed to it. It's still not perfect, but it's definitely important, and that's how we're gonna have more African-American women feel supported.
Thank you. And I am so sorry, but we are at time. I love you both. I'll talk to you later. Don't be mad at me. I'm getting the hand wave. So we are done. And I want to just thank you guys for coming this morning. I want to thank our amazing panel. Please make sure to follow all of our panelists on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. We will be around afterwards if you guys would like to ask us questions individually. Thank you so much.